in with the next presentation, and then we'll have a small break. Okay. The next topic is the basics on networks. So again, a topic, there's a lot of books on networks. They go into far much more detail than we have the time for, but it's essential that you know a little bit about the basics of networks. So at the end of this lecture, you should know the basic components of the internet. You should know what HTTP and DNS are. And I will also explain what happens when you enter an URL in your browser. So, why is it important? So, yeah, as I mentioned before, applications these days run on different servers to handle the amount of data. Yeah? So, you need some knowledge about computer networks. Also, many industries, these days, they don't manage their own computing infrastructure, but they use cloud services. So that's also all accessible over the internet. And you will also for and we will see that next week use these cloud services over the HTTP protocol and also for connecting and setting up these computers in the cloud. So very important networking. So here's a basic figure of a computer network. And we have a lot of, let's start that we have a lot of different devices. So, for example, your desktop computers, your smartphone, TV probably, also maybe a server. If you have your own server, could be the case. You have all these devices in a local area network, and they're connected with some type of communication link. So that can be radio waves, for example, Wi-Fi, or a fiber cable, or a copper cable, a copper for the TV, like that. Then, in your local area network, so you might have a switch, and a switch ensures, for example, that your desktop computer is connected to your printer if it's wired. And then maybe you have a router. So the router is often provided by your internet service provider like Telenet or Proximus. And then using that router, you are connected to the internet. So the internet itself is a whole lot of networks connected to each other. So you have a lot of equipment provided by your internet service provider that gets connected to another network for transatlantic, which connects with transatlantic cables to the US, things like that. So it's a whole networks of networks all connected through each other. So what's important? So at the end, at the border of your network, we have a router. These routers are connected with other routers and switches to some endpoints, and these endpoints are called hosts or servers. And also important, so the way all these devices in your local network or over the internet can send and retrieve information, it's done using protocols. And these protocols we're also going to talk about. So a protocol is nothing more than a standardized way of communicating. This is an example of the client-server model. So it's the most used conceptual model for communicating. And there are two roles. You have the client and the server. For example, the client is your web browser, and the server is the website of a sports or something. And what you do is you create a request, and you get a result or response back. So that's basically it. So in this schematic, so the client is your laptop or your smartphone, and the server is some process running in the cloud, or maybe at some company, something like that. One exception is that sometimes you also have peer-to-peer application, and there the clients are connected directly. So that's also an option, that the clients communicate with each other, and you have a really distributed kind of service, but that's not that common. Mostly we use a client-server architecture. And then you have a protocol. So here you have an example of TCP. So that's the transmission control protocol, and it's the basis of connections over the internet. So what happens if you go to a website, for example? First you make a TCP connection request, and then you get a response. Yeah? So the response or acknowledgement means that you have a connection with another computer. And after that connection, you can look at it as a kind of pipe. So you have like a communication pipe. And after that's established, you can send bytes to the server and get bytes back. So that's how it works. So here we first make the connection, and then we go to the VRT News webpage, and we get that webpage back. So these are two the way it works. And what's different, if once you have that connection, there's also an order of messages. So for example, you can click on the first website and then refresh again or click on something else. So there's information flowing back and forward. And TCP makes sure that all the messages are sent and retrieved in the same order. So that's something the protocol does. We have the internet protocol stack. So what's important with networks, you have an extreme heterogeneity of the network. So what it means is you have different hardware systems, software systems. So you have Wi-Fi signals, communication links, you have Ethernet communication, a lot of different operating systems and so on. So that would make it kind of impossible to have something like the internet, right? So how do we manage that? We have a complex system, and we handle that with layers. So you have different layers. We will see them in the next slides. And each layer is tacked on each other and provides a kind of service to the layers below it. That also means like you have the bottom layer, which is the details of the physical networking. So you have an abstract API on top of that. So that means you can change the physical network properties and have an abstraction, and then the other layers are not affected from that change. So let's see the example here in the internet protocol stack. So here you have four layers. So first you have the application level. And so application level, that's like communication between your browser and a web server. And so that's a very high level layer. So I can communicate with my browser by typing an URL, and I get a web page back, but it's very abstract. You don't know anything about which bytes you have to transmit, using which low-level network protocol. Is it Wi-Fi? Is it 3G, 4G? At the application level, you don't have to worry about that. You just communicate with a different process. And then you have the transport layer. So the transport layer means making a connection between two servers. So in the application layer, you maybe have a protocol like I want to get HTML pages from the web, and I will make a request to a web server. At the transport layer, you make abstraction of the application. So at the transport layer, You make a connection, so a pipe using TCP, and you can send any type of bytes between two servers. And the way TCP works, it does a best effort delivery of messages. And so it does its best to send a message reliable, and it does some checking. If some kind of message or is lost over the network, then it will retransmit it, but it's all transparent to you as an end user. So that's the role of the transport layer. Then you go one layer below that, you have the internet layer. So in the internet layer, you make abstraction that you have a network of network of networks, but you have one common layer, which is the internet. So that means every host has a unique internet protocol address and can communicate over a port. Yeah, so that's the internet layer. And then at the bottom, you have the link layer. So that's really the physical system. So for example, in your local area network, you have data going from your computer to your printer. If you issue a print command or between your router and your computer. But once you type in an IP address, the data packages will go to some kind of router and then connects to all these different subnetworks to finally it gets to its final destination. So that's the bottom layer is really the physical network. So if you look at the physical network, we use something called packet switching. So here it's an animation, but you cannot see it now because I saved the image to PDF. But in essence, you have two computers, host one and host two, and you send a message, and then the message is split into small packages, and each package traverses these nodes. These can be switches or routers between different networks, and they find their destination automatically. So they don't follow necessarily all the same path. They take different paths. And they also arrive in a different order. So if you send an email with a large attachment, like a large image, maybe those are thousands of smaller packages. And these are all distributed over the network. And all these packages have a chunk or a piece of the data you want to transfer. And at the end, the protocol will make sure that all these different pieces of your data are collected and reordered to recreate the original message. So that's how it works at the lowest layer. And this is another example of how, in this case, HTTP works. So HTTP is the protocol for how that's used by web servers. And here we make the comparison with scikit-learn because you already know that. So in scikit-learn, you have a service and you have an abstract interface. For example, each machine learning classifier has a fit method and a predict method. And using that interface, you can have many different classifiers, but they all work in the same way. You can have linear regression of nearest neighbors or whatever. They all have a fit and predict methods. The same is true for a web server. So in the web server, you have an init method where you make a connection to a certain server, and then you have a request. And the request has a method and an URL. So for example, you can go to VRT News, make a connection to vrtnews.be, and then you can request, give me the homepage or give me the celebrity news of today or the news of yesterday. And that's a request. And so each server, each website can decide how it implements these methods. So it's an abstract interface. And it's actually the same idea as in scikit-learn. So let's talk about HTTP. That's the hypertext transfer protocol. So the web is Allee, the websites and web pages are a network application, and it has a couple of components. So the first component is a standard for describing documents. It's called HTML. So what HTML defines, if you go to a web page, it defines the layout of the web page. Often you also have some client-side programs in JavaScript. So with client-side, I mean, they're executed locally in your browser. Then you have your web browser, Internet Explorer, Firefox, Chrome, which fetches the documents in HTML formats and displays it. So it knows how to display HTML, and it also knows how to make a request using HTTP. So it first makes a connection to a server, and then it makes a request using HTTP, and for example says, hey, give me the headlines of today from the VRT news website. And then on the other side, you have the server. So it receives the requests for all the different users. And for each user, it makes a connection after the requests and sends back the data. So in this case, the data in HTML. And the content of the web page. So again, a visualization here. So you have two users running, one running on Internet Explorer, one running on Firefox, and they make requests to a single server somewhere in the cloud, or maybe at the offices of the VRT for the VRT news site, and that server responds with to all requests of all users. So what do you do? You have a URL, like if you go to Chrome, and then you enter https://sportvoetbal.html. So there are three parts in that URL. So the first one is the protocol. So here it's HTTPS. So HTTPS, it's the same as HTTP, but it's secured. So that means your request is encrypted. And only you and the VRT know what you actually want to see. So that's kind of privacy, so that not everyone on the web knows that you're interested in football. Then you have sportsapp.be, which is the host name. So we'll see that in the next part on DNS. That sporza.be will be translated to an internet protocol address. And then you have sportvoetbal, which is a path to a file. So in this case, we will get football news. And there are different paths, obviously. So HTTP defines how you request a page from the web server and how the web server sends the web page. A web page back to the client. And then you can check that for yourself. So for example, if you use Chrome, you can go to View Developer Tools. And then you can open a website. And then you can really see what's going behind the scene. So I made a screenshot here. I'm not going to demo it live, but with the developer tools, it's actually made for developers. And so you can really have an insight in what's going on behind the screens. And if you do that for Dreamland, for example, you see several requests in the background. You have a request for the main site content, but also a request for all the media files, like for all these small images and fonts. You make a request. Also, in the case for Dreamland, it runs on Froomel for making recommendations, like what are the popular products or trending products right now. And also for Google, because Google is connected through many websites for ads and things like that. So that's all. You can also see that if you go to in Chrome in the developer tools. So that's nice to see. And these are all screenshots also from the developer tools in Chrome. So for HTTP, the message is composed. It's actually a text-based format. And there are three parts. So you have the first line, then you have the header, and then you have the body. So The first line is actually contains the URL. And also the request method. And the URL, yeah, it's something like www.dreamland.be, that's the host. The path is ANLDL, so that may probably means like the Dutch content or something. HTTPS is the HTTP over the secure channel. And then you have two request methods, get or post. So get is used to fetch something. You get a web page, you use that command. Post is used when you're sending data. So for example, if you have to log in somewhere, you have to fill in your username and password. That small piece of data, namely your username and password, you do a post for, you do a HTTP request, send a HTTP request message, but with a post method, and then it's used for sending data. And then what the server returns, is the, for example, the contents of the website in HTML or something, but also a status code. And status codes, in this case, it's 200, means everything is fine. Also, all the other codes that start with 2 means everything is fine. It also could also be that you have something like a 404, probably you have had that before, which means the page is not found, or some type of error. So that's also defined by the HTTP communication standards. After that first line, which contains the URL request method and so on, you have some headers. You have lots of headers, but I included the three most important ones. So you have the user agent field. And that contains information about your browser. So for my system, it says the user agent is Mozilla, Apple WebKit, Chrome, Safari. So these are some informations. So the website knows I'm using macOS 11.1, that I use a browser on macOS. So I think here I used Safari. So that's information you send to the server, because maybe depending on your type of device, like if it's a smartphone, you get a different web page back. Or maybe if you're running on Windows, some technical things change. And so it's important that that's also in your request to the server. Then you have the accept field, and that tells the server what you expect to get back. So one thing you don't want to get back are executables, because then any server on the web can send you viruses and stuff like that. So in this case, I only accept HTML pages or XML or all types of media files, like JPEG and so on. Is the user field the kind of information used to do fingerprinting? I'm not sure what you mean. You mean like a cookie? Cookies. I didn't discuss it, but cookies is also a field, obviously, in your request and response. And what happens normally the first time you go to a website, these days with the European law on privacy, you have to accept your cookies. And that cookie assigns a unique identifier to in your client, and that unique identifier is communicated back and forth with the server. So that's important if you have a session and the server wants to know what you have visited before, then he can track your behavior.
Professor, maybe it's easier if I post it through the microphone. I don't know if you can hear me.
Yeah, I can hear you.
Perfect. So fingerprinting was something we saw in the data science and ethics class, and it's similar to a cookie, but instead of using a piece of software, it tracks you based on the features of your device. So the type of device you're using, the OS, the resolution of your screen, etc.
Ah, yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, I must say, so with the user agent fields, you share some private information about your operating system. So potentially that's a security risk and also can be used to identify you. Now, I must say, like in my case, you have the user agent at this information here. But of course, there are millions of users who use my version of macOS and my version of Safari. Yeah? But together with my with other information, you can probably partially identify a user without cookies. Is that an answer to your question?
Yes, that sure is. Thank you very much.
Yeah, my pleasure. And then finally, the content type header is used to inform what type of content is back. And so usually, if you're a client, what you get back is text HTML or media files, such as image JPEG. We will also see some examples where you have JSON or XML that you get back. Yeah? So especially if you use that the developer tools, yeah, and you go to a website, you often see that some requests are also for JSON or XML, but these are in the background. So as an end user, you don't see it, but maybe there's some JavaScript and then you get recommendations from Frumo or something like that. And that gets rendered in your main screen. So, but each type of requests also obviously has a payload. So the actual data that is sent back, and that can be anything from images to structured data to HTML for visual data. So, addressing processes. So far we've talked about HTTP, and that's really on the application level, but there has also have to be some way to connect two processes. So with two processes, I mean, for instance, my browser and my local Chrome application and the process, the HTTP server that runs on the VRT News website or the Dreamland website. And so we need two things to identify a process over the internet, and that's the address of the host, so the IP address, and also an identifier for a process on that host. For example, you have the VRT server, but it might have Sporza, it might have VRT News, whatever. And so we need to distinguish between these different processes on the same physical machine. So that's done using an IP address, and an IP address, at least IP version 4, it consists of a 32-bit number. So that means you have four bytes, four numbers between 0 and 265. And that's actually a unique number to address any computers on the internet. Yeah? And once you have that unique address, you can connect to the host, and then you have to connect to the correct process, and that's done using a port number. And here's an example. I'm at my local house, and within my house I have a desktop, and you see that you have 192.186. So that's the most important part. It shared my router and my desktop, both start with these first two bytes. That's my local area network code. So that means if I want to go to my router, I go to this address, 192.186.1.1. And I connect with my router. And then my router has another number, another IP address. That's actually the public IP address. So when I connect to the internet, I have a public IP address. So in the entire world, this number is unique. And then I go over the public internet and I come to another router with 8182. And that's a server, that's the router, for example, of Dreamland. Now that router, again, is connected to a local area network. And here the local area network suffix is 10.0. Yeah? And then you have some server, and it's, yeah, maybe the 20, it ends with 21, so maybe there are a couple of hundred devices here, and that's that address. And then I connect with that server. Yeah? So what happens is I type, if I go to a website, actually behind the screens, I go from my router, which has a public IP address. It connects with another router with a public IP address. And then you have your local addresses within each network. And so the request, the HTTP message gets transmitted from my local computer to the router over the internet with the public IP address, and is acknowledged by the Dreamland server, and it can send a message back. So that's how it works. So that's good. And now the only problem is, in this scenario, you have to remember all of these IP numbers. So that's not going to happen. So then we go to domain name system, which is the system designed to handle those IP addresses. So an IP address has a hierarchical nature. So that means from the left to the right, we get more specific information. So the left number tells you which country you are, for instance. Then the number behind that tells which great organization, maybe Proximus or Telenet. And then you go to the last number, which is the individual computer in a subnet. So, for example, all the IP addresses starting with 81 and 240 until 81247 belong to Proximus. So Proximus and Telenet, obviously they're special because they're internet service providers, and they provide millions of users with a unique IP address. So they have assigned to them by an international organization this range. And then within this range, you can have the last two bytes, and you can have 10,000 of different customers. So each router has a unique address. So the problem with that scheme is that people are bad at numbers. So we give a name, like vrt.be or uantwerpen. So these are domain names. And every organization, they can create a domain name, and that means that uantwerpen.be is assigned an IP address. So that's what this does. It maps a name to an IP address, and it's a distributed database. So that means the DNS database, which contains the link between IP addresses and names, is distributed over the entire world, and it's actually implemented as a hierarchy. So for example, the BE domain name and the VRT domain, it's managed by the Belgian authorities. And then you have the top level, which is in the US, which divides all the top domain names to over an entire world, and so on and so on. So what happens when you enter a URL? So you go to sportzaad.be. in your browser. So the first thing you do is you have the host, sporza.be, but you have to know the IP address. So you make a DNS request. So you do a request, and usually you have some kind of local DNS server. So that's from Telenet or Proximus, and they will know the IP address of sporza.be. If they don't know it, they might go to the root DNS server in the US, maybe if it's a new domain, and then they will get it from there and then store it locally. So that for future reference, they don't have to go back to the remote DNS server. So that's what happens. Then they get the IP address, and then given the IP address, they make a connection. So they make a connection on a certain port to that remote server, and so that remote server uniquely identified by the IP address might have several services, but you use port 443. And 443, that's typically for secure HTTP, it's always this port. Yeah? And then you create a request message. So you say, I want to get the soccer point HTML page or something. And then using that same TCP connection, you get a package, you get a message back with all the HTML code and then other requests for the images and so on. So that's in a nutshell what happens. Okay, I'm gonna stop record now. Any more questions on this topic? It's a lot of different concepts, I know, but it's a small overview of networks. And then we have still half an hour. So I propose we skip the slides on the cloud and keep them for next week. And that we use our last half hour to talk about regular expressions. But first, any questions? Wait, what would you, how do we need to learn this? Okay. Yeah, if you, I think it's important you go over the slides, you know the main concepts. And I think for exam questions, I will provide some examples this semester. So maybe the final, in the last week or something, I think I will share some example questions on each topic, and then you can have a look at those to get some expectation on the difficulty. Yeah? But you just have to know the general questions. So for example, one question might be, what happens when you type in an URL over the internet? And then if you talk about, I'm going to look up the IP address using DNS and send an HTTP request and so on and so on, that's a correct answer. But obviously you don't have to go too technical, but you should at least know the general concepts that are important. And then the question before that, I use OpenDNS on most of my devices. Is first directed to that root server from the sites I visit. OpenDNS. Actually, I don't know what OpenDNS means. It's first directed using the DNS server from the site. Yeah, so usually, you can have a DNS server. So a DNS server is just a server which has a dictionary, which where names are associated with IP addresses. Normally, I think most users at home use DNS servers provided by Telenet or Proximus. If you're at UAntwerpen, it's a local server. I can even create my own DNS server at home. So if I do that, that means if I go to a website, I locally get my DNS name. I translate, get the IP address for any servers locally. And so also, I think if you're at the university, the network of the University of Antwerp, the DNS address is probably looked up somewhere on a server managed by the university. I'm not sure if that answers your question. Is that okay, Oberon? Okay. So let's take a 5-minute break and then I'll come back and do a brief tutorial on regular expression. Okay, let's continue with regular expressions. So regular expressions, yeah, the cloud slides, that's for next week. So you can ignore them this week. So regular expression, first quickly a few words. I'm gonna